Hello everyone, welcome to this talk on perfect sampling of K-colonies in graphs. This is joint work with my colleague Shaitan Chakraborty at IIT Mumbai and I'm Siddharth Bhandari. And since you're going to be seeing a lot more of me during this talk, I thought it is only fair if I flash an embarrassing picture of my colleague as well. So here is one of the many expressions my colleague gives when you prove something new. So let's jump straight into the problem statement. We are given a graph G with n vertices and maximum degree delta and some set of colors which I'm denoting by K. And we are interested in the set of proper coloring script C of the graph G. So proper coloring is just a vertex proper coloring where no two vertices which are adjacent receive the same color. And we are interested in the distribution pi, which is uniform over C. So pi puts equal mass on all proper colorings of the graph G. And what is our task? Our task is to sample efficiently and exactly according to pi. By efficiently, I mean something which is expected polynomial time in the input, and exactly means we cannot tolerate any error. That is, our output distribution must exactly be the distribution pi. So we are going to provide an algorithm which will take some randomness and output a distribution, and it should exactly be pi, unlike approximate sampling where we are happy with some total variation distance from pi. So this is something I would like to emphasize, and this is the punchline of the talk, that we are exactly sampling from pi. But in general, we know it's NP hard to even determine whether if script C is empty or not, even for, let's say, like k equal to 3. So to make our lives easier, we sort of assume that k is greater than delta plus 1, so that we have some hope of achieving this task. The delta plus 1 is really the greedy coloring threshold, because the greedy coloring algorithm will tell you that C here is not empty. And we'll assume that k is greater than C delta for some constant greater than 1. I would also like to point out that the naive accept reject will simply not work, where you color every vertex independently and uniformly, because the ratio of the size of C and K to the N is exponentially small, so it would take forever to generate a proper coloring. And what is the challenge of this field, or what is the thing that we are after? We are after finding the minimum value of K beyond which we can efficiently sample a proper coloring. So somehow the algorithms we design have this feature that if they work at a particular value of k, they work at all higher values of k. And we are sort of trying to find what that smallest value of k is. And I would say that the previous work, or the previous result to really compare in this line of work of perfect sampling of colorings, was by Huber in 98, where he gave a bound of delta square plus 2 delta. So if the number of colors is larger than delta square plus 2 delta, Huber gave an expected polynomial time algorithm which could efficiently sample. And I'm skipping quite a bit in between, but coming right to our result, we essentially improve that bound all the way down to linear. From quadratic, we bring it down to linear, and we show that as long as the number of colors is larger than 3 delta, we can efficiently sample from pi. So that's the punchline of our talk, and I hope this slide is clear. So now I'll introduce a rather popular method for sampling colorings, which is called global dynamics. Global dynamics is nothing but a Markov chain on the state space of all proper colorings of the graph script C, and its stationary distribution is uniform over script C, which is our target distribution pi. Now let's see how the global dynamics behaves, or how it evolves a particular coloring type. So we consider our favorite graph G, which is a triangle with three spokes, and we consider a coloring of that graph chi. And to evolve the coloring according to global dynamics, which we are calling chi prime, we first choose a vertex V uniformly at random from the set of all vertices. Then we simply copy across the color for every other vertex but V. So to assign the color to V, we make a choice C outside chi NV uniformly at random. So chi NV is nothing but the set of colors that appear in the neighborhood of V. So these are like the set of blocked colors. We cannot make a choice from chi NV, as it would produce an improper coloring. So we make a choice, let's say it happens to be yellow, then we just update the color at V to be yellow. And this is how simple a chain global dynamics is, and it will be heavily used in later algorithms. So now I'll talk about the more popular paradigm of approximate sampling of colorings. Here our demand is slightly weaker. We are happy outputting a distribution which is close in total variation to our target distribution pi. And typically we start with a fixed coloring x naught, and we apply to it the global dynamics transition t times, and output the random coloring xt at the end of it. And using coupling, we can show that the distribution of xt will be within epsilon in total variation of our target distribution pi, as long as k is large and we set t to be proportional to log 1 over epsilon. And in such cases, we call the global dynamics to be fast mixing. But this strategy is unfeasible for us, because we would require epsilon to be 0 to perfectly sample, and then this algorithm will take forever.
So now I would like to contrast some results in approximate sampling with perfect sampling. The first result is of Jerem, where he showed if the number of colors is larger than twice the maximum degree, Glauber Dynamics is fast mixing. Then Wobbly and Dyer reproved Jerem's result using a different framework of path coupling. Then Vigoda had a breakthrough result where he showed that as long as k is larger than 11 by 6 delta, the Glauber Dynamics is fast mixing based on flip dynamics. And very recently, Chen Delcott, Moitra Paradna and Postel have been able to improve the 11 by 6 threshold as well. On the other hand, for perfect sampling, the fact that it is at all possible is intriguing because we know that the approximate sampling doesn't work. We know that the naive accept reject doesn't work. However, Huber showed that as long as k is larger than some quadratic in delta, you can perfectly sample. Recently, Feng Guo and Yin improved Huber's bound, although their bound is still quadratic in delta. And there was this recent remarkable result of Liu Sinclair Srivastava, which implies a perfect sampler whenever k is larger than 2 delta, but they require bounded degree graphs. So for general graphs, we were still stuck with the quadratic barrier, and this work breaks that quadratic barrier. We show that as long as k is larger than 3 times delta, we can perfectly sample efficiently from the colorings of the graph. And we make this result comparable to the best approximate sampling algorithms. So let's enter the framework of perfect sampling now. And the general question to ask is, given a Markov chain P with a stationary distribution pi, can we somehow use P to draw exactly from pi? This question was beautifully answered by Prop and Wilson in 96, where they introduced this coupling from the past framework. The basic idea behind coupling from the past is to imagine evolving many Markov chains, one for each state in the state space from minus infinity to zero. And although this may turn a few mathematicians in their graves, let's imagine we can somehow do that. Then if P is ergodic, the underlying chain is ergodic, and somehow our joint evolution has a non-trivial probability of any two chains coalescing in the future, then we can expect that by t equal to 0, all the chains would have coalesced to a unique state omega star, and then the algorithm just asks you to output omega star. And the claim is that omega star is exactly distributed according to pi. The rough intuition behind this is that since the chain, each chain has had infinite time to evolve, it should reach its stationary distribution pi. And we would skip this proof in the interest of time, but this can be formally proved, whatever I just said. So now I would like to present the coupling from the past framework somewhat pictorially. So we have talked about evolving chains from minus infinity to zero. So that evolution is going to take place with the help of our update functions UIs. So we are sort of imagining minus infinity is on the left and we are progressing towards zero. And each update function UI is nothing but a random function from omega to omega with just one property, that if I track the evolution of a particular little omega in the state space, then it looks like one walk of the Markov chain has happened. So this property is basically the property of respecting the underlying Markov chain P. And once we have this sequence of UIs, once we realize such a sequence of UIs, we are now trying to find the first index t such that when we compose these update functions, the image of the function is a constant or is a unique element omega star. So maybe we try, let's say at time t equal to I, to understand whether the image is omega star or not. So initially the image is taken to be the full set omega, then it shrinks as you keep on applying various update functions. Maybe by t equal to 0 you have not found that the image has shrunk enough to be a singleton. So then you go further back in time, and as you then you iterate from a different time step like minus t in this case, and the image will shrink further and further. At some point you will find a unique element in the image, and that is what you output. And such a thing is reasonable to expect because it is clear that the images are consecutively shrinking. So if I look at the image of the function u minus t to u minus 1, it will be a subset of the image of u minus t plus 1 composed all the way to u minus 1. And the other thing to note is that the evolution of the chain from minus infinity to minus t, that is u minus infinity to u minus t, is now irrelevant, because no matter how the chains end up at u minus t, we are always shrinking to omega star. So now let's look at the CFTP applied to our favorite example, that is a random walk on the line 1, 2, 3 up to n. This is our usual random walk where each element moves to the left with probability half, to the right with probability half, and itself loops on the ends with probability half. So its stationary distribution is clearly the uniform distribution on n. And let's see how the CFTP works for such a random walk. So we have to evolve chains for the entire state space. So in this case, these are 5 elements, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And using these update functions, UIs, that we have been talking about. So what will be UIs in our case? In our case, UIs will be described by these random variables tau minus 1, tau minus 2, tau minus 3, and so on, which are chosen uniformly at random between 0, 1, and independently across time. And the way an update function, a particular update function UI, acts on an element j is by moving it to the half to the right if tau is greater than half and to the left if tau is less than half. So it should be clear that we are simulating one step of the random walk, which is what we needed to do. And then the CFTP algorithm just sort of says that go and find the first time in step t, such that when you compose u minus t to u minus 1, the image is a constant and you just output that constant image. And so this sort of UI, this tau sort of succinctly describe the joint evolution of various chains. Either they are moving to the left altogether or to the right altogether. So now I would like to introduce the coupling from the past framework for colorings. So recall that we are trying to simulate the global dynamics chain on the set of all k colorings of our graph, which basically boils down to describing these update functions UIs about which we had made noise. So just like in the case of the toy example being the random walk where the update functions were described using these random variables tau, in this case the update functions will be described using a tuple sigma comma b. Well, what is this? What is sigma? Sigma is just a randomly chosen permutation of colors. And V is just a randomly chosen vertex from the set of all vertices. And how do we plan to evolve a particular coloring chi when it is hit by an update UI? Well, we will change the coloring of the color of the vertex V. The rest of the vertices will remain the same. And how do we change the color of the vertex V? We use the first available color as prescribed by sigma. So that is the first color outside chi NV as prescribed by sigma. So in this case, chi NV consists of two colors, which is blue and red. So when we look at sigma, we cannot use red because red is already blocked, but we can use the next color, which is yellow, and this is exactly how the update has happened. So it should be clear that this is going to simulate the global dynamics because the choice of color that chi prime V takes is uniform over the set of free colors because sigma is a randomly chosen permutation. So great, so we have laid out how the CFTP looks like, but what, so now we are chasing after the first time index where the image becomes unique as the CFTP prescribes. But what are the issues in implementing such an algorithm? Well, there are two. Firstly, the time. How long back in the past do we have to go until the image becomes unique? And the second more important issue is the space. Like, how do we keep track of these chains? Because the number of chains is exponentially many, since that corresponds to the number of k colorings of the graph. So let's now see how we can sort of deal with the space issue in case of our favorite example, which is the random walk. So in case of the random walk, if you recall, we had this property that that the walks which were moving to the left or the right was completely determined by the tau. So in this case, the tau t would have been greater than half because every walk is moving down. And in this case, the tau t would have been sort of less than half. So all the walks either move to the left together or move to the right together, and this is something we can sort of exploit. So to check whether the image of u minus t to u minus 1 is a singleton, which is exactly what the CFTP asks us to do, we only need to keep track of the evolution of the trajectory of 1 and 5, because it should be clear that every other trajectory will be sandwiched between these two green and red trajectories, and that is something we can exploit to sort of save on space. But unfortunately, such a total order on the trajectories or such a natural order on the trajectories is not available for colorings, and that is why we need to do something different. And that's exactly where the method of bounding chain comes in. This was a generalization of the previous idea, which was introduced independently by Huber and Hagstrom and Nylander, and it helps us keep track of those exponentially many colorings that we need to evolve for the CFTP algorithm efficiently. So what is a bounding chain? It is another Markov chain, and its state space is to the k to the v. So in other words, at any time t and at any vertex v, we are going to prescribe a list of colors at that vertex instead of a single color, which is a usual Markov chain. And what does a bounding chain help us do? It helps us answer whether the image of u minus t to u minus 1 is a singleton in the CFTP algorithm. And the properties of the bounding chain are that it can efficiently check whether this image is a singleton without false positives. That is, whenever the bounding chain says that the image is of size 1, it is of size 1. And as an added benefit, it also sort of tells us the time complexity. It says that if k is large and t is said to be this polynomial in n, then the probability that the image will be a singleton is considerable, is half in our case. Let us now dive a little deeper into what bounding chains are. So as we saw, a bounding chain prescribes a list of colors at a vertex v at time t, and we want to check whether the image of u minus t to u minus 1 is a singleton for the CFTP algorithms for colorings. That's what we are using a bounding chain for. So when we start at time minus t, the list prescribed at any vertex v by the bounding chain is just the set of colors k, and as we evolve through time, we are going to maintain an invariant. What is the invariant? So let's consider any coloring chi which is a proper coloring, and as we keep on applying the update function to that coloring, we sort of evolve that coloring through time, and let's say that we evolve it up to time t. So we applied the update function ut and obtained chi t, then it must be the case that chi t is captured by the bounding chain at time t. What that simply means is that if you look at any vertex v, the color that is prescribed by chi t must be one which is in the list of the bounding chain. So like for this vertex, the only available color is blue, since any other color will not be trapped by the bounding chain. And here again you can see that the color yellow is also being trapped by the bounding chain, and this must be true for all colorings. So it is exactly in this sense that a bounding chain, which is a polynomial sized object, helps us keep track of exponentially many colorings. So this is the invariant we are going to maintain throughout minus t to 0, and if at the end we find that the list size prescribed by the bounding chain at every vertex is of size 1, then we uniquely understand what coloring the image contains, and in fact the image has become of size 1 now because of the invariant. So now let's see how Huber proposes to evolve the bounding chain algorithm. So let's just recall the CFTP for coloring. So we were generating these update functions sigma comma v, and we were changing the coloring chi at the vertex v by using the first color outside chi nv, which is prescribed by sigma. And this is how the bounding chain will evolve. So for the evolution of the bounding chain, Huber sort of splits up the update rules into a warm-up phase, which lasts for n log n steps, and into a coalescence phase for n delta log n steps, and we will sort of see why the terminology is being given. So during the warm-up phase, we start with the bounding chain at minus t being full, so every vertex v is assigned the complete list k, and we will evolve it, and let's try to sort of see how the evolution looks corresponding to time step I, where the update ui, which is sigma I comma vi, has been generated. So the evolution rule is very simple. So we just update the list at the vertex v to be the first delta plus 1 colors according to sigma I, and we just copy the list across for every other vertex which is not v. So let's see the rationale behind such an update. The rationale behind such an update rule is actually quite simple, and it is best understood by understanding how the invariant is maintained by such an update rule. So we consider a coloring chi which is trapped in the bounding chain at time I, and we consider applying the update rule ui to this coloring. So we generate the coloring chi prime. Now we know that chi prime will change its color at v as the first color according to sigma I, which is outside chi nv, but such a color would definitely be found in the first delta plus 1 elements of sigma I, since the max degree of the graph is at most delta. Therefore the invariant will always be maintained, as the color chi prime v will always be contained in the bounding chain list prescribed at v. So at the end of the warm-up phase, if we touch every vertex, which will happen with high probability, we know that the list size now at every vertex has dropped from k to delta plus 1. So we have made some progress. Now towards the aim of the coalescence phase in Huber's algorithm is to have some non-trivial probability of dropping the list at a vertex to be of size 1. And so let us consider a particular update ui which happens during the coalescence phase, and to understand that update more closely, we need to understand a definition siv. So siv just denotes the union of the colors in the lists of neighbors of v, and the thing to note is, if you consider a coloring chi which is trapped in the bounding chain at time I, then siv represents a superset of chi nv. It is a superset of all block colors. So Huber divides the update rule into two cases, the first case being when sigma I1, that is the first color according to sigma I, itself is outside SIV. In this case, we can be certain that chi will update itself using sigma I1. So the bounding chain just updates itself to be sigma I1. In the other case, we just give up and use the first delta plus 1 colors like we were doing during the warm-up phase. And one can show that the invariant is maintained by using a similar idea as we did in the warm-up case. The thing to really note from this slide is that case A is progress, because the bounding chain becomes of size 1, and that happens more often if k is larger. And case B is regress, because we have a larger bounding chain which is of size delta plus 1. And at progress, we use this definition WT, which is the set of vertices at any time t which have the bounding chain to be of size 1. And at the end of our algorithm, we would like mod W0 to be n, because then all the vertices are size 1. And you can see that mod WT actually performs a random walk on 0, 1, 2 up to n, with 0 being reflecting and n being absorbing. And Huber showed that this random walk is actually going to happen with positive drift as long as k is more than delta square plus 2 delta. In such a case, if you set t prime appropriately, you can show with high probability absorption will happen. But the thing to note is that if you look at Huber's analysis, it actually shows that what you require is that k should be larger than the worst case list size that happens during the coalescence phase, which is delta plus 1 for Huber, which is the case B of our previous slide, times delta plus an extra margin of delta. So this gives us the bound delta square plus 2 delta. And let's see how we are able to exploit this for our algorithm, which gets So let us now look at how the new bounding chain performs. Like Huber, we will have a warm-up phase and a coalescence phase. Our warm-up phase will last for n delta steps and the coalescence phase will last for n delta log n steps. At the end of the warm-up phase, our guarantee is really strong. We are saying that the bounding chain at every vertex is of size at most 2, unlike Huber where it was of size delta plus 1. And during the coalescence phase where we are tracking this index mod wt, we get a very strong guarantee that the maximum list size we ever see during the coalescence phase is of size 2, unlike Huber where it was of size delta plus 1. So now if we just replicate Huber's drift analysis, we see that for the positive drift of mod wt, we require k to be larger than the max list size times delta plus delta, which just turns out to be 3 delta. So the thing is, how are we able to perform this strong guarantee guarantees for the two phases? Well, the main idea is to change the underlying CFTP process itself in such a way that the bounding chain method sort of becomes more efficient, because after all, the list that you are producing at a particular vertex is a measure of the uncertainty you have in the coloring during that time. So at one particular phase of our algorithm, which is the warm-up phase, so we start at time t equal to minus t, and we start with the bounding chain at that time being full, so every vertex has size k, and at the end of the warm-up phase we are producing lists which are of size at most 2. So how are we able to do this? Well, let's just focus on a particular vertex u1 and let's see how we are able to bring its list size down to 2 during the warm-up phase. And to achieve this, we will require two kind of updates. One is going to be of type compress and one is going to be of type contract. And I'm going to be really quick through our algorithm, which will be more detailed in an extended version of the talk. So let us now look at one particular snapshot of the warm-up phase where we are trying to bring the list size at u1 down to 2. So the way the underlying CFTP process will evolve is by applying the compress update delta times from t equal to minus t to minus t plus delta once for each neighbor of u1, and then finally applying the contract operation at u1, which will bring the list size down to 2. So let's see how the bounding chain will actually evolve during this time. So the bounding chain starts off being full, and then we apply the compress operation for the three neighbors of u1 in this case, and then finally the contract operation at u1, which brings the list size at u1 down to 2. So during the compress operation applied to the bounding phase, we are producing list of size delta plus 1 like Huber, but here is the difference. So what we are actually trying to do during the compress operations is we are trying to spruce up the neighborhood of u1. That is, if you actually look at the union of the colors in the list of the neighbors of u1 after the spruce up operation, after these three compress operations, stu1 will be of size 2 delta versus delta times delta plus 1, which could happen in case of Huber. So the way we are able to do this is by assigning a common set of delta colors to all this list so that the union is small, although individually the list sizes are large. And finally, the contract operation is able to make the list size at u1 go down to 2. So in the interest of time, I'll skip how the compress update actually happens. This is going to be detailed in the full version of the talk. So now let us look at how the contract update behaves, and I'll just give you a very quick flavor. This is more detailed in the extended version of the talk. So recall, the goal of the contract operation is to contract the list size at u1 from k to 2. So it really makes a lot of progress. It is applied at the end of the spruce up operation to the neighborhood of u1. So we know that the neighborhood of u1 in the bounding chain is of small size. A contract operation is specified by a triple sigma tau u, where u is the vertex u1 for us, and sigma is just a random permutation of colors, and tau is just a random number between 0 and 1. So consider any coloring chi which is trapped in the bounding chain at time t, and let's see how the contract operation acts on chi. So we produce the coloring chi prime, which differs from chi only at the vertex u, and for the color of the vertex u, we first consider the set of all colors k, and then we know that stu is a superset of the block colors for any coloring chi, and our aim is to sort of color chi prime in such a way that the uncertainty in the color of chi prime u is as small as possible. So to do that, we first choose a color c1 outside s uniformly at random. The reason for doing that is we at least know that c1 is always a valid color for chi prime. However, this alone is not sufficient since we are not putting any weight on s minus chi, which we need to do for the global dynamics. That is why we make another choice c2 within s, which may happen to lie within chi or it may happen to be outside chi. And then we just make a probabilistic choice of color at u using the random variable tau. So with probability p, we choose just c1. This happens if tau is less than p. And with the remaining probability, we choose c2 if possible. Otherwise, we'll just choose c1. And this is exactly what sigma is for. It's just for the choice of c1 and c2. And to show the existence of such a p, we need to have a good gap between k and stu. And that is the reason why we spruced up the neighborhood of u so as to make it 2 delta. And the bounding chain now just evolves accordingly. With 1 minus p, it just becomes c1, c2, because in that case, we do not know what it is. But with probability p, we become c1, because we know that chi prime u is always c1. And at the end of the contract operation, the thing to note is that the bounding chain at u1 is not only of at most size 2, but with some non-trivial probability, it is of size 1 as well. Let's now move on to the coalescence phase of our algorithm. So the coalescence phase actually tries to reduce the list size from 2 to 1, while in the worst case keeping the list size 2. And we've actually done all the hard work we need, because it's just a repeated application of the contract update. So this is how the underlying CFTP process evolves during the contract, during the coalescence phase. We just repeatedly apply the contract operation, and the bounding chain, we've already discussed how it evolves, and we just exploit the fact that there is a non-trivial probability in the contract update of reducing a list of size 1, and we get our bound of 3 delta using the drift analysis we've already discussed previously. So that's it about our algorithm. And now onto the open question. So there's a very natural open question to ask, that can we push this perfect sampling bound all the way to 2 delta? Well, why 2 delta? Because 2 delta seems like a natural limit which comes out of path coupling. And there is some good news that we can actually show that there are some update functions which coalesce quickly when k is larger than 2 delta, which is also called grand coupling. The issue is that we do not have an accompanying bounding chain to work with that CFTP process. And this is a question that I've been thinking about for some time, but I have not made progress beyond 3 delta in this question. And that's it for the presentation. Thank you.